This is the Detroit Sports Podcast Network.
CBD is a game changer sweeping the nation. This hemp extract is the natural way to elevate your mood, eliminate aches and pains, reduce anxiety, and keep you sleeping all night long. It can even cut your workout recovery time in half. Get in the game today with 20% off all orders of CBD and lavender products from Lavender Lane, a lavender farm located right here in Milan, Michigan. Just go to lavenderlanemi.com today and enter coupon code DETROIT for 20% off your entire order. Guys, look, these amazing products are infused with calming lavender to maximize their effectiveness, meaning your CBD items only take minutes to take effect, which is way quicker than those pills you were about to swallow. On top of it, they are perfect for men and women. Lavender Lane has lab-tested CBD creams, tinctures, and roll-ons that are perfect for any situation, even if you're on the go. Put your health back in your hands by heading over to lavenderlanemi.com and entering coupon code DETROIT for 20% off your entire order of CBD and lavender products. What do you have to lose? Your satisfaction is guaranteed or your money back. So if you need lavender gifts for your loved ones or just looking for the natural way to ease your discomfort with CBD, go to lavenderlanemi.com and use coupon code DETROIT to unlock these miraculous benefits of CBD and lavender. That's lavenderlanemi.com. And remember, use coupon code DETROIT for 20% off your CBD and lavender products from Michigan's own Lavender Lane.
Welcome in to the Monday Mashup. It is December 30th. You heard that correct. December 30th. Holy cow. Time flies. It's the last Monday Mashup of the year 2019. My name's Kevin McCann. Shea is not here this week. He's traveling for the holidays. We got a lot to cover today. It's going to be a little bit shorter of a show because obviously I'm by myself. But NFL playoffs start next week. I know everyone's very excited about that. I know I'm not the person you want to hear talk about it because I'm me. But still, we're going to talk about it anyways. We'll give you at least the preview and a couple of picks. Only four games next week, obviously, but still, everybody loves that first weekend. Wildcard weekend's fun for everyone. We're into that sort of time period in the NBA that just sort of drags along post-Christmas, pre-All-Star break, late December, January, and early February. So I thought we'd have a little bit more fun with the NBA than just talk about what's been going on the last couple of weeks. And instead, we'll whip around. We'll cover all 30 teams. I'm going to try to do it in less than 30 minutes. And we'll pick one player or one fun trade they could make, one interesting move they could make, whatever it might be. And we'll, again, try to cover it in under 30 minutes. Before we get to all of that, we got to talk about the DFS doctors because, folks, you got to get over to the DFS doctors on Twitter, at the DFS doctors. If you play FanDuel and you feel like you aren't creating consistent money-making lineups, then you got to go see the guys at the DFS doctors. Find them on Twitter, at the DFS doctors. DM them with the promo code Detroit Sports. That's all one word, Detroit Sports, to get a free trial. Forget this, they're analytically formulated 70% lifetime profit rate on NFL and NBA lineups. You got to get over there and do that. It's a free trial. You have absolutely nothing to lose. And this is a 70% lifetime profit rate. You got to get over to the DFS doctors on Twitter. DM them promo code Detroit Sports for the free trial. Thank you again to the DFS doctors. All right, let's get right into it. Freddie Kitchens was fired today. I guess we should mention that. We should start with that. Someone lost their job. If you didn't think Freddie Kitchens was getting fired by like week seven, I don't know what to tell you. That was going to happen. So that's the least shocking thing ever. Already hearing whispers about Mike McCarthy, about Ron Rivera. Those are the two biggest guys mentioned for anything that are former coaches, I guess you could say, and aren't college coaches. Personally, I have no idea what they're going to do. I don't know what route they're going to take. The Haslams are as unpredictable owners as they get. I guess you'd want to bring in like a super innovative offensive mind, but I think that team needs more of a Ron Rivera guy, a guy who can just kind of control their locker room and make everybody coexist and love each other and work hard and buy in and all the great things that make football something that I'll never be able to understand. As for next week, the New England Patriots, folks, Shea isn't here, and that's probably for the best because he'd be very, very upset right now. I'm sure he is very, very upset right now. Ryan Fitzpatrick should retire today because it's not getting better for that. Like, Ryan Fitzpatrick is not a Super Bowl quarterback, so you beat the Patriots at home in Week 17. That's good. Be done. That's it. That was Fitz magic at its finest. I I don't know what to say. I did not see that one coming. The Patriots do not have a bye for the first time in like 10 years or something crazy like that. I don't even know what it is. They get the Titans at home. The Titans played A.J. McCarron today. I think most people found out that A.J. McCarron was still in the NFL today. They won a game. I give them credit for winning a game. It's not easy to go on the road and win a game, blah, blah, blah. You didn't learn anything about them today. I wouldn't say they're rolling. They've looked better, but Ryan Tannehill has been Ryan Tannehill, and I think he's going back to Ryan Tannehill next week in Foxborough, and the Patriots get back on track, and maybe they need a game. Maybe they need a game to get back on track. Maybe they're going to be fine. I don't know, but I'm taking New England in that one. Buffalo and Houston. This is an interesting one to me because I believe we saw it a couple of weeks ago, and if I recall correctly, I don't have it in front of me, but Houston, for me, in this one, again, played A.J. McCarron today. Like, you're not going to learn a whole lot playing A.J. McCarron. It's just sort of like a, I guess everyone's healthy, we can't do anything, blah, blah, blah. We're not going to play A.J. McCarron. Or we're going to play A.J. McCarron. Excuse me. So you didn't learn anything today. Who knows if they're rolling. They still can't protect Watson. They're kind of a hit-or-miss team. If Will Fuller plays, they're twice as dynamic. If he doesn't play, who knows what happens. I actually think I'm going to take Buffalo in that game. I like Buffalo's defense going down to Houston. I'm going to take Buffalo. I think Josh Allen's going to... I don't know. I have no basis for this whatsoever. I'm taking Buffalo. That's my opinion on it. Do what you will with that. Minnesota and New Orleans is a very interesting one to me because it just doesn't seem like Kirk Cousins is the guy who's going to go to that dome and win a playoff game. That would seem sufficiently out of character for Kirk Cousins to do. So, I think Minnesota's a good team, even though they lost to the Bears today. Granted, they didn't play anyone, so is what it is. You can't really take a whole lot from these Week 17 games. If Dalvin Cook plays, they've got a chance. I'm taking New Orleans, though. Kind of running away, if I'm being honest. The next one, the last one, is the most interesting one of the weekend, so we saved the best one for last. The Seahawks, I mean, it came down to the wire today, and a delay of game cost them at the end, and they moved back 6 yards, so they can't hand it to Marshawn and have what would have been just an unbelievable moment of Marshawn over the top to win a game. That sucked. Also, there was an obvious PI the play before the last play of the game, and it didn't get called, and it would have been first and goal at the one with, I think, 12 seconds left, and that's another thing we're just going to look over, that they didn't buzz down and correct their officials when, I mean, that was blatant pass interference on the linebacker from San Francisco. I don't remember who it was. But you got to make the call. It's just, I sit up here and bitch about the officials, but for what? For what? So that's the quick little NFL wraparound. What was that, about 7 minutes? Yeah, quick little NFL wraparound. Again, I'm not going to be able to give you too much because my NFL knowledge is based on just trying to play devil's advocate against Shea usually because I'm not the NFL guy. But take that for what it's worth. If you bet on those picks and you win, slide your boy, you know. A little under the table. Break off a little piece. Maybe something. Maybe a little something. Hit the DMs. All right, let's get into basketball because that's where we'll actually have some fun here today. Again, it's December 30th, right? It's that point in the NBA where Christmas is past. The excitement of the Christmas Day games are gone. Nothing else is really coming. This is why they want the midseason tournament, folks, because it's just sort of a dead period. The Super Bowl takes over till the middle of February, and then we have the All-Star break for the NBA, and then we take over for those last 25, 30 games, whatever it is. And that's really when everybody who is a casual NBA fan starts to really pick it up, right? So let's talk a little bit about the trades. We had one. It was not nearly enough to satisfy my craving. Jordan Clarkson going to Utah for Dante Exum. Oh, poor Dante Exum. That must have been a really difficult text to get or phone call, however you found out. I pity you, Dante. It's been a rough go for you. Hopefully you buy into John Beilein's collegiate system and something works out for you down the line, but I don't think it will in Cleveland. That trade, for the most part, not going to do anybody any good other than maybe Utah gets some bench buckets. It's sort of just a swap. Let's see if we can figure something out. We need a little more punch. I'm going to go around. We're going to go through it. I'm going to go standings by standings. So we'll go from 15-1 in the West and then from 15-1 in the East. I'm going to pick a guy or pick a trade, and I'm going to tell you what the framework of a deal for that guy looks like or what maybe that team should be interested in because there's not a guy on every team they should move. We'll start in the West in a place that, man, if you'd have told me this a few months ago, I would not imagine we would start with the 15th-seeded Golden State Warriors at 9-25. There are not a whole lot of deals for them to make right now. I think what's going on with the Warriors is obvious to everyone, and it's sort of a scrap it year. We'll run it back next year when everybody's healthy. That doesn't mean we're not getting Steph back in late February. We might get Steph back. They might not entirely tank, or they might bring him back and only play him 20 minutes a night. But I think we might get him. We might see Clay at the end of it just to get some run in. Who knows? So we still might have a little fun from them yet, but I don't think we see any trades with them until closer to the draft when they know what their pick is, when they know or when they have a better idea of where D'Angelo is going to go. I will say this, and I don't want to spend too much time on it because it is a shot in the dark theory right now, but come July 1st, the Milwaukee Bucks can place a Supermax offer in front of Giannis. And if he does not sign it immediately, the clock starts to tick on how long before we trade him, because no one else can give him that money, and it's the most amount of money he can take. So if he says, well, it's not about the money, then as an organization, you have a duty to probably trade him. And I don't know that there's a real better trade for what you might want than to say D'Angelo Russell and the number 1 to number 3 overall pick for Giannis and a bunch of other stuff that they might want. Here's the thing. 29 teams are going to make an offer for Giannis. Everybody's going to try. So if that happens, which I'm not saying it will, if I were him, I would sign that contract, and then maybe I'd force my trade later if I have to, but bro, secure the bag. All right, let's move on to New Orleans. This is a fun one for me because I went through this and there was a million different guys you could pick. Are they seriously going to max Brandon Ingram? Do they want to do that? Because that's a super interesting one. They could get a boatload for him. J.J. Redick's an obvious one. Everybody wants shooting, and J.J. Redick is an automatic 16 points and 44% from deep. To me, the most interesting trade candidate, not the most interesting one, but the most obvious one, is Derek Favors. And a team that needs big man help, and I haven't heard his name mentioned with them yet, and I'm surprised because I think it kind of makes a little bit of sense. The Boston Celtics could use Derek Favors a lot. And if Danny Ainge is willing to part with one of those first-round picks, not a good one. I mean, maybe it doesn't even take a first-round pick, but some kind of filler to get him, I think Favors is a really good fit in Boston. So to me, the interesting one for New Orleans is Derek Favors because the other ones are obvious. If they don't like Ingram, then he's going to get traded. If they're going to move Redick, they're going to move Redick. It is what it is. Let's move to Minnesota. The 13th seed in the West, and just sort of a rough last 15. You know, they're 31 games in. They started pretty decent. They're 3-11 at home this year. It's not great. They're 1-9 in their last 10. That's even worse. The idea of selling high on Andrew Wiggins has almost passed you by in a span of like 20 games. Like 20 games ago, you might have been able to get something decent for Andrew Wiggins. I don't know how much he could turn the corner again. Maybe like he's still averaging a lot of points, but he's still being Andrew Wiggins-y. The interesting one here is Robert Covington. I think Robert Covington is a great trade candidate for any team because every team needs wing shooting and defense. So what does the framework look like for Robert Covington? Would it take a first and a good player salary filler? What is Minnesota looking for? Are they looking for something, obviously, in the point guard department? They don't like Jeff Teague. They want to move off him. But at what point, when you're 11-20 and 1-9 in your last 10, do you say, we're not making the playoffs in the West, we're not going to trade for a guy better than Jeff Teague, we need someone younger? So what does the framework look like? What are they looking for? I think it's probably closer to draft picks and younger players. There are other wings out there. I don't think Minnesota can afford to be too picky. If they're going to move off Covington, it's probably going to be for a late first round, middle second round, a decent pick. They might be able to get more for Wiggins, but there's such a big number attached to him that I just don't know if they will. Okay, the 12th seed, Sacramento Kings. This is an obvious one. Dwayne Dedmon asked to be traded, so let's just focus on Dwayne Dedmon. A lot of teams need a big man. I just mentioned Boston. That's another candidate. Dwayne Dedmon could probably fit pretty well in Boston. There are some other teams that could somewhat use big man help, but that's the main one I'll focus on. Like I said, I want to keep this on under a half hour, so we're going to move off Sacramento because they're not interesting at all. The Phoenix Suns. This is an interesting one because at 12-20, you're sitting a game and a half back of Portland for the 8th seed. You haven't made the playoffs since Nash left. You need desperately to make the playoffs to appease the dude you just gave $156 million to. Now, you got him a point guard. You did that part, and good, because they seem to be a good fit. DeAndre Ayton coming back has not been a smooth transition. They are 2-8 in their last 10. It has not been trending well for them defensively, especially when Ayton is on the floor. And I think Monty Williams will be able to reach him a little bit. He's a great coach, and he's done a good job there so far because they've already won 12 games. Well, they won 14 all of last year. They were terrible. So I like the idea of maybe shopping for another wing. I like Kelly Oubre already, but that team losing T.J. Warren has, and again, I understand how bad they were last year, but wing shooting would help. Another shooter helps. Another guy who can stretch the floor helps. It's why you drafted Cam Johnson at 11. Probably wasn't the smartest idea, but remember, this is a team that had a Josh Jackson as the number 4 pick that they were hoping to grow on the wing. It obviously didn't work out. I think a wing trade for them is what makes the most sense. Now, what can they give up to get it? You can't give up your draft pick from 2021 because Miami's already traded it like 15 different times. You can give up your draft pick this year. I don't know how much you can protect it, and I don't know where you're going with it. To me, the interesting thing is, I'm going to talk about this next team right after them, because I think they have a framework of a deal, is an Andre Iguodala. So we'll work into Memphis here as a nice little segue. Andre Iguodala has been talked about in Houston. Andre Iguodala has been talked about in L.A. Andre Iguodala has been talked about in the other L.A. Here's the thing. Those teams have to wait for a buyout, and Memphis doesn't want to buy them out. It's going to take a team to come in and give something decent, and Phoenix is that sleeper team that could say, will he come here and play for us? I bet he has a lot of respect for Monty Williams. I know he's familiar at least with James Jones from the finals that he played against them. I know James didn't see a whole lot of time then, but it is what it is. I think Andre Iguodala fits well in Phoenix. I like that pick a lot. He's obviously the main guy we would focus on in Memphis as we move into Memphis at the 10 seed in the West right now. Iguodala hasn't been there all year. He's not coming. That's clear. So as you get closer and closer to February, he's going to be moved or he's going to be bought out. I don't think they want to buy him out. All signs are pointing to they don't want to buy him out. So a trade makes sense. I like Phoenix. San Antonio at 9. Whew, boy. You could go down the line here and you could pretty much pick a name. They're not playing their two guards that everybody was so excited to see together. So that would lead you to believe Derek White is somewhat available. DeJounte Murray has a very tradable contract, but I don't think you trade him this soon after an injury that took a whole year to come back from. Give him this year, see what he is next year. I was hoping for more out of him this year, but it is what it is. Teams need shooting. The Spurs are in the 9 seed. They have some, depending on where they go with this, are they buyers or sellers is the most interesting question. They have to reshape at least something. They can't just go forward with what they have. So maybe you don't want to trade one of your stars. Well, how about a guy like Rudy Gay? Rudy Gay is another guy on the wing, gives you ball handling, gives you playmaking, is a smart cutter, great cutter, gives you defense. If he can stay healthy, he's played in the playoffs. He's got a lot of experience. It won't take too much to get him, and he doesn't make that much money. So Rudy Gay is the interesting one for me in San Antonio. Now, where could he end up? A lot has to shake out. You look around the East, who would need a wing? Maybe a team like a Brooklyn. They keep getting hurt. What do they have to offer? Not a whole lot. Philly's got to make a move. Maybe Toronto would shake things up. He's been there before. Who knows? I'm not sure where Rudy Gay ends up, but I like Rudy Gay to be the guy who gets moved in San Antonio first. Let's move on to Portland. Obviously, the name would be Kevin Love. I don't know how they go get him other than Whiteside and picks. I don't know how he fits. I don't think he gives you more than what Melo has given you, so I think that ship has sailed. If Portland, I just think they're too banged up to trade anyone right now. I don't see it with Portland being able to make a move that really makes sense to lift them from the 8th seed in the West at 14-19, 3.5 games back of the Thunder for the 7. So let's get to the Thunder because this is a fun one. They have a ton of trade candidates. Everybody wants what the Thunder has right now. It's a bunch of guys who they're waiting to do a rebuild. Like, they're sitting there on this treasure trove, and I do mean treasure trove of picks that they've gotten from LA for Paul George, that they've gotten from Houston attached to Chris Paul. They have to move Chris Paul eventually. Both sides, I heard Woj say on the Woj Low special, both sides don't think that's going to happen this year. I tend to think that's what teams who want to trade somebody and are letting on that, you know, we're not just going to move him for nothing will say. I think they're holding out for a deal for Chris Paul. He had another great game today against Toronto. The Thunder won in Toronto. I've been impressed with him. I don't think he's an all-star anymore, but could he push the team over the edge? Absolutely. Now, would Miami come to get him? It'd be tough. Miami doesn't want a lot of money tied on their books because they want a shot at Giannis in 2021. Everybody wants a shot at the 2021 class. LeBron James is a free agent in 2021. Who knows? Who knows? So for the Thunder, Steven Adams is the guy, right? He's the one who would probably get moved. I know Shea wants him in Boston. I know a lot of people want him in Boston. I think we've mentioned Boston on a couple of other big guys already. They need front court help, although if you ask Enes Kanter, they don't need front court help at all. I like Dennis Schroeder to get moved first because, again, I think it takes less to come get him and somebody will come get him. He doesn't make too much money. He's a great guy who you can plug in and play as a starter and a backup, and he's not going to be high maintenance or worried about it like people were early on in his career. I think that's sort of softening on that opinion. Moving on to Utah. This is a tough one for me because I picked them in the conference finals just off the fact that I thought the Lakers and the Clippers would not be the 1-2 and that would somehow finagle itself. And, you know, so far it has, that they would play themselves beforehand and Utah would be the team that ended up there. It has not looked even remotely like that, but 8-2 in their last 10. Now, a lot of this, without Mike Conley, leads me to believe they might just pull the trigger. I know it would be unprecedented to trade for a guy in the summer who is of the pedigree of a Mike Conley and as good of a player and as easy to get along with and as universally loved as Mike Conley, and to part with him right away and cut your losses and just see what you could get for him. But any team willing to trade for Chris Paul should at least be calling Utah on Mike Conley because it doesn't look like a fit. They've looked more like themselves with Ingles back in the starting lineup. He just really makes that offense move. He's such a good ball mover. He thinks two steps ahead. And when he gets those minutes, when he gets to play with those guys, they're just so much more dynamic on offense. And it's not a knock on Mike Conley because he's phenomenal, but it has not seemed to really be a fit. So I think there's a chance you see Mike Conley get moved. Maybe not. It would be a tough, tough thing to explain. But if you could find a deal sort of doesn't make you worse, even if it doesn't make you better, it just makes you different, but it doesn't make you worse, I think you might want to do it if you're Utah. Houston. Okay, this is Houston. This is Daryl Morey. They're going to make a move. They always, no matter what it is, Daryl Morey is going to try to trade for anyone and everyone. They got beat today against New Orleans. It is what it is. No Harden, no Westbrook, no Capella. You're going to take a loss. Though Eric Gordon, I think, only played 22 minutes also. So Houston making a move is almost a virtual certainty. Now, where do they go to make that move? You would think probably Capella, right? You're not going to trade Westbrook. You're not going to trade Harden. You handicapped yourself, and I can't stress that enough. I understand the want to give Eric Gordon an extension because he's been great for you, and he deserved it. He absolutely deserved it, and you needed to save a little face because you just sent Chris Paul out when you said you weren't going to, and that's the head of the players' union, so you needed to show other players, look, we take care of guys who have been here and done this. We gave Eric Gordon this extension. Now, here's the problem. You can't trade Eric Gordon. Now, you're going to want to keep Eric Gordon, I guess, in a sense, because you want the shooting that he provides, but if you can get better somewhere else, you're willing to give up a guy like Eric Gordon who makes the amount of money that is almost perfect to be traded. You handicapped yourself. An extension means you can't trade him. The only place to look now, seemingly, is Capella. If you're going to move Capella, you have to get big men back. You can't not have a big guy. The lack of defense in your guards, you need to have that stopper behind him. So I don't know what Houston does, but it's almost a virtual certainty they'll make a move. The LA Clippers are the fourth seed in the West. Now, granted, they're three games back of the one, and they just beat the one on Christmas Day. Really stole one from the one on Christmas Day. I do think they make a move. I do think that move is probably for Andre Iguodala if they can. It's going to be another wing. They're just going to keep getting guys that allow them to be insanely switchable on defense because you saw what it did to the Lakers down the stretch of that fourth quarter. When you can switch 1 through 5, it is, I mean, they're a nightmare. The only guy, you're just trying to attack Lou Williams late because Pat Bev is guarding 1 through 5 if he has to and he's a bulldog. All those guys can switch. Harrell can even hold his own on wings. Those guys are a nightmare defensively. So where do they go? Yeah, Iguodala would make the most sense. That's another wing that can just completely be switchable. Marcus Morris, they offered him $40 million. He's going to be available. We'll get to that with the Knicks soon enough. That's another wing guy. We mentioned some other wings. I don't think they would even remotely think to swing on Wiggins, but if they could get their hands on Robert Covington, I bet they'd do it. There are a lot of wings out there. Mo Harkless isn't doing enough for them. There are a lot of wings that could be moved that make a good enough money for them. Look at Mo Harkless. I don't think they would ever consider moving Lou Williams, but that contract is just so movable. I mean, it's ridiculous that he is only paid that much. Dallas. Dallas got beat by the Lakers tonight. Big shock there. Luka is tremendous. Any move you make, oh, it seems insane that you'd say we'd have to run it by our second year stuff, but you do. You got to make sure that he's okay with playing with whoever you bring in, because that dude is not just the future of your franchise. He could be the future of the sport after Giannis. So who knows what Dallas would do, what they're looking for. I would love to see them go get a good point guard. And a guy like Mike Conley would make sense for them, but Utah trading them to a team in front of them doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So maybe you look at an East point guard. Could you make a move for... Nope, there really aren't point... You could try and take a swing at Kyle Lowry. I don't think you'll have any luck. There's one guy who obviously Dallas is interested in because they almost traded for him this summer, and he's very close with Luka. So we're going back to that. Who would Luka bring in? And if you could get an established point guard, it would just depend on what you'd have to give up for Goran Dragic. I think you'd almost have to take money from somewhere else. It'd have to involve a third team, but Goran Dragic is the name I would watch if I'm a Dallas Mavericks fan. If I'm looking at what they would want, it's got to be a point guard who can take some of that load off Luka, who can run more pick and roll with Porzingis. That is a great fight and a great fit if Dallas could pull in Goran Dragic. And they had him in the summer. They almost did, but I don't know what happened there. The Denver Nuggets. Now, everyone around the Denver Nuggets, everything you're hearing is, if they're going to move somebody, Gary Harris, and we're targeting Drew Holiday. I don't know if Drew Holiday is going to get moved. If the Pelicans are going to be bad, it would seem like they're going to get moved. We touched on that earlier. They're sitting in the two seed. They're two games back of the Lakers. They don't necessarily need to make a move right now. They need to get better, because obviously what happened to them last year in the playoffs is bound to probably repeat itself if you run into the Lakers or the Clippers in the second round. But I think Drew Holiday doesn't necessarily push you past either one of those teams. And that's not a knock on Drew Holiday. I love his game. I love Drew Holiday as a player. I just don't know that he is enough to push you past the Clippers or the Lakers in a second round series. Probably enough to get you past to Houston. But I don't know that you're going to see Houston and be that lucky. So who knows? I think if Drew Holiday is the guy, then it has to be Gary Harris and a combination of other stuff because the contracts fit too well. But I keep an eye on younger guys. Would they be willing to move off Porter? It seems he's untouchable, but who knows? The Lakers, there's one guy they can trade. Everybody knows it's Kyle Kuzma. They have no other move to make. The tweets this week from his trainer and... you could allegedly say him. He seemed to endorse it, though tweets are not endorsements. I don't know. He could have been tweeting about something else, blah, blah, blah. I think he was tweeting about that. He's the guy to move. The young team that would want a young guy like Kuzma, and what are you getting back for him? Those are the two biggest questions to me. Do you want more front court help? I don't think you need it. I think Davis is going to play all the minutes in the playoffs, and you can rotate Dwight and JaVale next to him, and you'll figure it out when you want to go small and put him at the five, because I know we haven't seen too much of it. Anthony Davis plays a ton of power forward and barely any five, and I do mean barely any five, but when those playoffs roll around and they want to switch more and they want to take those guys off the court, I don't think you need to trade for another big. I think you need a wing. So are you willing to move Kyle Kuzma for Andre Iguodala? That starts to become the conversation. Can you move Kyle Kuzma and whoever else, a combination of whatever, can you get J.J. Redick and player X from the Pelicans? You already have a good rapport with them. You've done trades with them. What do they do? I don't know. Kyle Kuzma's the guy who's probably getting traded. Okay, that's the West. I don't know how we're doing for the under 30 minutes thing, but we'll try and fly through the East. The Hawks are bad. They are the 15th seed in the East. They are the worst team in the NBA. They are 6-27. They are, I believe, 3-12 at home and 3-15 on the road. Not great. They have lost 10 in a row. It is bleak. Lloyd Pierce is probably not going to last after this season. And really, you can pick a young guy. Who would they want to trade? Who do they want to get out of there? It's pretty much anybody but young Collins and Hunter, right? They could maybe move Herter. They could maybe move Cam Reddish. It's probably too early for either of those guys. So the guy to keep an eye on is probably Jabari Parker. A team might come after an Alex Len. That's a sneaky one for the Celtics, but I don't think the Celtics really want Alex Len. But that's a sneaky one. A team could come after Alex Len as a big guy. He's okay. He's okay. Jabari Parker is the one to watch. Offense, no defense. We know the story with Jabari Parker. Teams that would look at him I don't know, Brooklyn, like maybe he fits kind of okay in like a Dallas, but would you want him? Is he really what you're going after? I don't know. There's not a lot of moves for the Hawks to make. They stink. Let's move on to the Knicks, who stink also. The move here, Marcus Morris is the guy probably because he makes a good amount of money. He can go to a lot of different places. Like I said, San Antonio obviously wanted him last summer. The Clippers offered him a lot of money. That's why Rich Paul isn't his agent anymore. I could see him with the Clippers. I could see him a lot of places. He's probably the guy who gets moved out of New York. I don't want to spend too much time on the Knicks because they suck. Dennis Smith Jr., another sneaky one. There's whispers everywhere that he wants out, so that's one to watch, I guess, too. Who cares? No one likes the Knicks. The Wizards, they can't trade Beal at all. He's locked up to an extension. That doesn't make any sense to anyone at all, but the Wizards are the Wizards. They're doing what they're doing. Scott Brooks is still the coach there, so how that is even remotely answered, I don't know. They're 2-8 in their last 10. They stink. Davis Bertans, I know Shea would salivate to get him in Boston. I think that's a great fit. I think there's a lot of teams that would love to have a 6'10" guy who can defend and shoot threes. He has been so underrated this year, not talked about enough. He's a sneaky most improved candidate. I think Davis Bertans winds up somewhere else before February. I would keep my eye on that one. Again, I don't want to spend too much time on the bottom of the East. Cleveland already made a trade. They're 12th. Their team hates their coach. I think it probably had a lot to do with the guy they traded first. I think that's probably why he got traded first, because I think he was probably the dude who was talking. It would seem like a Jordan Clarkson thing to do. So they got him out of there. The guy they would love to get out of there is Kevin Love. The problem with that is Kevin Love makes a lot of money, and Kevin Love is not that good for that much money. You see it in places like Philly when they pay Tobias Harris too much, places like Houston, they pay Chris Paul too much. And it's not that Kevin Love is too old, because he's not that old. But in big man years, and more importantly, in white guy big man years, Kevin Love is 106. So the fact that he makes that much money makes him very, very difficult to trade. Portland is really the only team that would have made a whole lot of sense. Like, again, you could look at a Brooklyn, but he makes way too much money. You could look at... You can't put anything past Toronto, but he makes way too much money and he doesn't fit. There's a lot of different things. I don't know that Kevin Love's going to get traded this year. If he does, it's not going to be for what they want. I think you might be looking at like a next year buyout, Kevin Love. I don't know. There's just not that many deals out there for him. So now let's get to the team everybody wants to talk about. The 11th seeded, 12-21, Detroit Pistons, who are 3-7 in their last 10. Their point differential is in the negatives. They are one of the most frustrating basketball teams in the NBA to watch, mainly because they either start Tim Frazier or Bruce Brown Jr. at point guard, and that is a laughable statement in and of itself. If the Pistons don't blow it up soon, I mean, they're already bottom of the barrel in attendance. They've been putting off a rebuild for 10 years, literally for 10 years. I don't know what you think is going to happen if you're a Pistons fan, if they make a move for a DeMar DeRozan, or if they make a move for a whoever, but it's not going to work. I promise you it's not going to work. Small market teams have one way to build. You trade, you get your draft picks, and you do it that way, and you try and keep your players, and sometimes you do and sometimes you don't. Look at Indiana, they didn't get to keep Paul George. Well, you make a good deal and you get yourself an Oladipo. We'll see what happens with Milwaukee and Giannis. Obviously, it didn't work with LeBron or Kyrie in Cleveland. They're both gone. Minnesota, Kevin Love, same thing. But that's what you do. You get stars through the draft. You build through the draft. We've been putting it off for 10 years. It's just time to do it. Everyone is available. Everyone's been available. Don't kid yourself. If they could get a deal for Blake, he would be gone. They spent all summer trying to get a deal for Reggie. He's still here because nobody wants him. The Pistons will make a move. I pray to God. It might have to be Andre Drummond because he's the only thing they can trade right now. They need to do it now, though. They need to start selling assets like they're going underwater. It is beyond, because they already are underwater. It's beyond terrible. Do it now. I don't even want to talk about it anymore because they're so bad. Do it now. The Charlotte Hornets. This is an interesting one. The emergence of Devontae Graham has made Malik Monk ridiculously expendable, right? So you have Rozier, you probably paid him too much, but he's even been better than Monk, so I'm not going to hate on Terry Rozier right now. Malik Monk makes sense for the Detroit Pistons. He's a young guard with some upside. You could get him for Andre. I don't know why not. You'd have to take on Nick Batum's contract. It's expiring. It's not terrible. I mean, it is terrible, but it's expiring. It's going to come off your books. I think he might have a player option. God, I hope not. But you need young guards. You need guys with upside. It's why you don't take Sekou Doumbouya in the draft, and you take a Kevin Porter because he looks pretty good in Cleveland. Like, not great. He's playing in Cleveland, but better than really any young guard you have outside Luke Kennard. And Luke Kennard's hit or miss on most nights anyways. So that is what it is. I like Malik Monk getting moved out of Charlotte. I think he's the most likely one to be able to attach to Batum and get him somewhere. So if you're trying your desperation to get off Batum's contract, that's the one. Maybe you have to attach him and to Miles Bridges, but who knows? Depending on what they get back, depending on what they want to do, I think they're right now 2.5 games out of a playoff spot behind Orlando. I'm sure they'd love to make it their first year without getting Kemba back. It would probably do a lot of goodwill for that fan base to know at least we can get in the playoffs. We couldn't keep Kemba, we can get in the playoffs. To the 9 seed. It's laughable this team is in the 9 seed because some nights they look like they're worse than the Hawks and some nights like they put it together and they score. It's the Chicago Bulls, everyone. Jim Boylan's Chicago Bulls. Another frustrating team. The deal that everyone's been waiting on since I think before the draft, or at least the night of the draft when Kobe White became a Bull, is Chris Dunn. They played Chris Dunn at the 3 in their last... I mean, they don't know what the hell they're doing with Chris Dunn. So if I'm Chris Dunn, I want out just as fast as I can. I'm not sure who would come after a Chris Dunn. Obviously, a young point guard with some upside left. Defensively, he's a monster. Offensively, it hasn't evolved the way you want it to. He was a phenomenal table setter in college. A really great collegiate point guard. And it just sort of hasn't worked. So middle first round pick, second round pick, something you can get for Chris Dunn. Could you package him with a first rounder and get anything worth it? Probably not. Are you willing to move off one of your young big men this early for something else? Probably not. So then let's look at Zach LaVine. Zach LaVine's averaging 23.5 a night. He does it somewhat efficiently and he gives you absolutely nothing on the defensive end, which just doesn't fit with what your coach is. So maybe take a note, if you're Garpax, from what you did last time. When you saddled, you got a good coach in Fred Hoiberg. The guy knows offense. He's smart. And you saddled him with a bunch of dudes who never fit his system. The one chance he had to get the guys who fit his system after D-Rose moves on to New York in the trade, Joakim Noah signs there, you have some room, you have some other things, you spend it on Dwayne Wade and Nerando. It's two guys who can't shoot. They never fit his system. Don't do the same thing again. Zach LaVine isn't a Jim Boylan player. And I don't think Jim Boylan is a good coach, and I don't think he should be your coach, but the fact of the matter is, he's your coach, and he's on a 3-year deal, and you might be able to get something that fits a little better for Zach LaVine. So maybe move Zach LaVine, go that route, I don't know. Orlando, the 8th seed. Orlando was the 7th seed last year. They're sort of an organization bathed in mediocrity. When Weltman and Hammond took the job over, they said they'd get a title by 2030. So that's, you don't typically say that when you take it over. That's too long. Don't do that. Again, just mediocre. So Mo Bamba, what are you getting for Mo Bamba that makes you better right now? Vucevic makes a lot of money because you paid him. It hasn't been as great as it was last year, but I still think he's a good player. He could be front court help for a lot of teams, but again, there's a big price tag to him. The obvious name, the name that is one of the most perplexing players to me in the NBA because it's year 5 and I still don't know what the hell he is, but he's got a great contract for him and I think he's actually good, and it's Aaron Gordon. They have to move Aaron Gordon. They have no other choice but to move Aaron Gordon because they just don't know what he is yet. Like, they've tried to make him a 4, they've tried to make him a wing, they said shoot too many threes, now be a passer. He's a more athletic Draymond Green, but he's not nearly as sensical or IQ savvy as Draymond Green. He's got a lot of work to do in that regard, but that's what you see him as. A guy who can facilitate, a guy who can move the ball. He cuts hard, he plays well, he sets good screens, he rolls hard, and he's good on defense when he wants to be and when he's locked in. He's a good passer, an underrated ball handler for his size. He can start the break off a rebound. He can help a lot of teams that need a 4 or a wing. He's got a decent contract. It's not super team friendly, but it's team friendly enough for a team with a little bit of space. The Brooklyn Nets. Let's segue right into that because he fits there. A guy who could take the ball when he need him to take the ball, but most of the time he's going to be a good screen setter for Kyrie. He's going to be a good screen setter for Dinwiddie. He could roll hard. Think Aaron Gordon fits well in Brooklyn. Now, what would Brooklyn give up to get an Aaron Gordon? They don't need Jared Allen in Orlando, though I'm sure they love him, but they've already got too many young big men they don't know what to do with. The piece for Brooklyn that could get traded is very interesting because it's probably Caris LeVert. He holds a lot of value. The issue is the health, and would a team remotely think about giving up anything of value for a guy who has been healthy literally every year he's been in the NBA, or been unhealthy literally every year he's been in the NBA, excuse me. I don't think so. So when it starts to come down to what could Brooklyn do, I think Brooklyn starts to look at, you know what, maybe we don't do anything this year. Maybe we stand pat, we see what we are to start next year with KD, and then we make a move then. They're sort of just kind of lying in the weeds. Wilson Chandler just got back from suspension. They could talk themselves into just seeing what they got. I think that's probably the route they go. Indiana's going to trade Miles Turner, right? Like everyone thinks Indiana's going to trade Miles Turner as we come to the Pacers at the sixth seed in the East. The big men, it's not a debate. Sabonis is better. It's been clear this year, far and away. Like the fact that they got Domantas Sabonis and Victor Oladipo in that Paul George trade is bravo to Kevin Pritchard. Phenomenal. Mwah. Delicious. I think a Miles Turner trade is another one where you got a big man. He led the league in blocks last year. He can step outside and shoot it. Somewhat team friendly. I think it's like a 4-for-80 something deal. He could do a lot of things for a lot of teams who need rim protection. I'm thinking like a Houston. He played his college ball in Texas. That could be a fit. Again, what the hell can Houston give up? You don't want Clint Capella to play next to Sabonis because now you just got a guy who basically is Turner but can't shoot. So I don't know what they're going to do with Miles Turner, but that's the guy if we're picking guys as we go through this. I would keep my eye on probably being moved. Justin Holiday is another one. Rangy, long defender. I feel like he gets traded every year. He can shoot. He can defend. He's a wing. Someone will take a flyer on him. Maybe a team like this next one we're coming to with the five seed Philadelphia 76ers. Not a top four team in the East as of today, December 30th. They have to make a move. They have no other choice to make a move. I understand the high of a Christmas Day win against a team that has been terrorizing the league for this year and making a guy who's been a supernova look like the opposite of a supernova. It doesn't matter. They have to make a move. They can't trade Simmons. The extension hasn't kicked in. They can't trade Simmons, so that's off limits. They can't really trade Embiid mid-season because I don't think a team is going to completely go all in on trading for Joel Embiid in the middle of a season because it's going to be a team that's going to want to build around him and do some other things. So that would happen maybe this summer if it happens. I think you got to point to Tobias Harris, which stinks because they gave him that contract. He did not give it to himself, okay? No one else was out there clamoring to give Tobias Harris 5 for $180. It wasn't happening. So they have only themselves to blame for it. They need shooting, and they need guards. Yes, they could move Josh Richardson. They could, and they could just stay really big and trade for another guard who's just a shooter. They're a J.J. Redick candidate again. I would be doing not whatever it takes to get Redick, but if I could get him, I'd get him back as quick as I could if I'm Philly. Justin Holiday, like I just mentioned, is another guy. Makes sense for them, but is not as good at what J.J. Redick does as J.J. Redick. So shooters, backcourt help. They could trade someone off the bench. They could trade Azaire Smith. They could do a lot of things with their young guys like a Matisse Thybul. I wouldn't trade him, but he's a candidate. The Toronto Raptors. Okay, this one is tough. But the Raptors have always been, Masai Ujiri in particular, has always been the guy who no matter what, he's going to make the deal. Okay, he sent DeMar DeRozan out, right? And that's the most important move they made last year, obviously acquiring Kawhi Leonard. But they don't win that title without Marc Gasol. And he could have just sat pat and said, you know what, we've got Valanciunas, we've got DeLon Wright, these have been integral parts of our team I'm not going to trade them right now. We're sitting at the two seed in the East. I'm not going to trade them. I'm not going to do this for Marc Gasol. And he did it. He pulled the trigger, and they needed to do that. They needed to go all in. Even though he had Serge, even though he all had this, he needed Marc Gasol. So I think maybe the same thing happens again. Marc Gasol isn't an expiring. Maybe he goes out and gets a different big man. Maybe he goes out and finds another guard. Be able to put Fred VanVleet on the bench again would be enormous for this team. So finding a two guard that can play, you know, they didn't just lose Kawhi, they lost Danny Green. Finding a two guard that can defend or can just shoot, and I mean, I've mentioned JJ Redick a lot of places. Man, does he fit in Toronto. I mean, just running around screens, letting Siakam handle the ball, letting Lowry handle the ball. JJ doesn't need it. They need a shooter. They need a two guard. They need to be able to put VanVleet back on the bench. I think it'll cost them Marc Gasol, which means Serge Ibaka is your center going forward, and whoever you get back as a waiver center, whatever you want, you could pick up Enes Kanter. He seems to like Canada already. Either way, they need to get another guard so that they can put VanVleet back on the bench, because that's how they get to where they need to be. The Boston Celtics are the three seed in the East, which is damn good, because I'm not sure that too many people had the Boston Celtics at three. I think a lot of teams probably had them top five, but three at this point, I'm not sure. 22-8 in their first 30 is outstanding. 7-3 in their last 10. They're 13-2 at home. They've been damn good in the Garden. Everyone in the world who watches the Boston Celtics or watches the NBA knows that they want to trade for a big guy. They need a big guy, whether they trade for him, whether they get him on the buyout, whatever it is, they're going to go after a big guy. We've mentioned several already, so I'm not going to dive back into it too big because I already ran over the 30 minutes. But a big guy is a necessity. Steven Adams, we mentioned him. Alex Len's a sneaky candidate. I don't really love that one. Derek Favors was the guy I mentioned first and foremost when we started this thing. I think Derek Favors fits really well, and I think he's the guy that doesn't cost you near as much as those other ones. Defensively, does he give you everything that a Steven Adams will give you? Not terrible. If Adams is like an A-, Favors is probably a B+. So I like Derek Favors there. I think Boston obviously is going to make a move for a big man. That's my pick for them. The Miami Heat are the two seed in the Eastern Conference. They're 24-8. They've won 8 of their last 10, 8-2 in their last 10. They've won 5 in a row. They are 15-1 at home. They have the ultimate South Beach advantage. Teams have been coming in to South Beach and getting walloped. Literally the only team to beat them in South Beach is the Lakers. The deal for them, obviously they would love to move off Dion Waiters. James Johnson has not been a part of their rotation. He has a team option, or a player option next year. Dion Waiters is, there are a lot of words I could use, but none of them are nice. I don't think he's going to play another game in a Heat uniform. I think they're trying to get it out there that they're open to bringing him back because they know they can't trade him now. I don't know where they go with Dion Waiters. I don't know what they do with Dion Waiters. But yeah, obviously they love to move Dion Waiters. To me, the guy is Goran Dragic. They were going to move him this summer. They had a deal in place with Dallas. I don't know what the hell happened, but he's still on the Heat. The thing about Goran Dragic, he has been phenomenal as a sixth man for them this year. And when he's had to start, he's been great too. He's made Tyler Hero a lot better. He's made Kendrick Nunn at least not have to be as great as an everyday starting point guard because he has Goran Dragic backing him up. Bam Adebayo's been outstanding. Jimmy Butler is an outstanding ball handler playmaker for them. They're sort of blessed with that, so they can kind of make Dragic expendable because those two guys can handle the bulk of the playmaking. Do you want a shoot-first point guard? Do you want... what are you looking for if you're moving Goran Dragic? That's the main question. Another wing would help them, because like I said, James Johnson hasn't been in their rotation. They could use another wing. Winslow's come back. He's been good. Winslow's another sneaky candidate to get moved. Some teams might want Winslow. Do they go after a Chris Paul? That's been the main speculation, right? They're the team that's going to come get Chris Paul. I really don't think that's going to happen. I don't think that's going to happen this year. If it does, color me shocked. But, you know, I don't see it. I think Goran Dragic is the movable piece. I think he probably gets moved more than likely because, again, he's on an expiring and he's not going to come back to be the sixth man. They'll give him a hell of a lot of credit for being a great one this year. He's been huge for that team. Okay, the Milwaukee Bucks. I'm glad we saved them for last because this is the one. where you look at, and I just mentioned this a minute ago, what Toronto did last year, knowing they had these rotations and set, these guys love playing with each other, they've been together a long time, all that, and they still made the move for Gasol at the deadline. They're going to face, John Horst is going to face a decision in Milwaukee. It's going to come at the deadline. He knows, okay, I might only have a year and a half of Giannis left. I've got to make a move. I've got to do it. Now what's that move? And could it be trading Chris Middleton? Who's going to take that contract? He's averaging 18.5 points a game, and he's on a 5 for 177, just like Tobias. Can Eric Bledsoe draw anything on the market? I don't know. Maybe. A team that really desperately needs a point guard? Yeah, maybe. The problem is, I don't think you're going to get something back for Bledsoe that makes you better. He's just tradable. What can you give that gets you back a piece that's any good? What could you give to get an Andre Iguodala or to get a like player, a great wing or a good... Would it cost Brook Lopez? Would it cost anything not named Giannis? Yeah, probably. So John Horst is going to have to really, really look in the mirror and really, really think hard if he has to make a move to get better. Maybe he doesn't. Maybe he sits pat and says, you know what? I really like what we got. We're rolling with this. More often than not, that doesn't end well for you. It's the team that makes that final move. You never know. Not a starter always. Obviously, that's only happened twice. Shout out to Sheed and last year with Marc Gasol. But can they find that one guy? That one guy that pushes them over, Iguodala off the bench or whoever it is that gets them there. So that was 30 teams. It was a little more than 30 minutes, so my apologies. But I think we did pretty okay there. Good week for basketball coming up, obviously. Football playoffs coming up. It's going to be a great week. Hope everybody has a good time. We will see you in 2020. Shea will be back. I will be back next week. And that was a Monday mashup. Have a great week, and we'll see you soon.